We just want to take a look at the year that was 2017, the major events that happened. What were they for you? Was it SGR? Was it the election? Was it the calls of succession? What really stood out for you as a Kenyan? And I have a great panel with me this morning. Daniel Juma Omondi, the Global Peace Fund, is here. And Steve Ogola, who is a High Court advocate lawyer, is also here this morning. Gentlemen, first of all, Happy New Year. And thank you so much for availing your time to come here. Let me just start with a general question. For you, Daniel, what was it that stood out in 2017?
Thank you, Zinzi, and Happy New Year to everyone. I think it's a beautiful morning, and we are happy to start the new year at the KTN studios. I think the elections really stood out. As you know, every election year, Kenya has a lot of controversies, and this was one of them where, you know, people politicked for more than 8 months, you know. Campaign started early and ended, you know, it's still going on as we're talking today. Yeah, but that stood out. But one thing I must congratulate Kenyans is that we went through the elections without incidences like the ones we saw in 2007, 2008.
Right.
We were here calling for peace, and Kenyans listened to us, and they were basically peaceful during the election year.
Yes. And the thing is, this 2017 has been a unique election year in its very own. Two in one. We had the August and, of course, October. Kenya being the very first African country to annul an election.
Yeah.
Third or fourth globally, if I can remember correctly. So 2017 was very unique in its own way, despite the fact that it was a political year. Steve, for you?
Thanks, Zizi. I think, as Dan says, election was a big issue. In 2017, there was also the question of gross violation of human rights.
Mm-hmm.
That was well documented. And then there was the question of wastage and pilferage of public resources. That just indicates to us that we still have a long way to go in terms of ordering our governance systems to make sure that it complies with the Constitution. Talking about the Constitution, I think the Supreme Court determination of the presidential election petition stood out in a very significant way.
Right.
And Kenya enjoyed for a moment the pride of place in Africa and the entire world, because it's not every day that you see Supreme Courts nullifying or annulling a presidential election. Indeed, that has not happened in Africa. So that really stood out. But I think also a critical observation which may provide lessons for reflection and learning is the culture of non-compliance with the law. I think our politicians showed us that they have the capacity, you know, an established capacity to entrench impunity.
Right.
That they can operate within the law when they want, they can operate outside the law when they want, and that it's only you and I, ordinary Kenyans, that should be bound by the law. I think that was something that really stood out, and I hope it can be addressed in 2018. Going forward.
Mm-hmm. One of the major events that Kenyans are looking forward is what NASA is saying, electing Mr. Raila Odinga and Mr. Kalonzo Musyoka. Do you see this coming to pass, Daniel?
Okay. I don't have all the figures, all the facts, but all I can say is that the elections are behind us. And just like you said, there was a lot of issues with non-compliance with the rule of law. It's unfortunate that our elections have always to be this controversial.
Mm.
In other countries, elections come, you know, people vote, votes are counted, and life moves on. The winner accepts, and the loser usually concedes defeat and congratulates the winner. But the manner in which we did our elections, you know, unfortunately, you know, I think we allowed the controversies to play on, and this denied the chance, you know, for the loser to feel like they lost honorably.
Right.
I think this is one of the things that we have to fix moving forward. Seeing NASA and what they have been calling for, I think they've been calling for dialogue. And when the former Vice President Kalonzo Musyoka came, he said they're looking for dialogue on electoral matters. I think this is very critical because we need to bring closure,
right,
you know, to these issues. And when it comes to dialogue, I think we should not choose what we are talking about and what we should not talk about. We should be able to open talk about everything, so that we avoid a situation whereby, you know, we still have this issue prolonged going forward. So that is what I can say about the issue. Whether it's going to happen or not, I don't know, you know, because, you know, it was to happen before.
Yes.
But it
didn't happen. They postponed it about 3 or 4 times.
Yes. So I don't know. But if you ask me, I think NASA is just looking for a chance to be at the dialogue table.
Right.
Yeah, and if President Kenyatta can be magnanimous in and be able to invite them and talk about the nation, I think it's one country. And, you know, public service is just about serving the nation. People should not fight over serving the nation. I think if people want to serve, and if, for example, the opposition feel that they have something to offer, you know, I think the government, you know, the president and his deputy should be magnanimous and sit at the table and ask them, how can we work together?
Daniel, you brought in the issue of dialogue. And really, Steve, do you think the lack of dialogue that we're going to see, or maybe if it will come up if President Uhuru Kenyatta and his deputy decide to sit down with NASA principals, do you think that the dialogue will see a change within the constitution for Kenya? Do we see a constitutional crisis coming?
Well, I think what we need to do is to understand what are the options available for dialogue, because dialogue, yes, is an inescapable reality.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, the constitution requires a consultative, deliberative, and negotiated approach to governance. So the president must necessarily open all avenues for dialogue. But we must also know what the constitution has settled definitively. In terms of the predictable pathway that we spoke about many times last year, my goodness, how time changed.
Yes.
Now, election of the president is a consequence of Article 138, sub Article 2.
Mm-hmm.
The outcome of that election is declared in terms of Article 140. Disputes are also resolved in terms of Article 140. The outcome of the election is declared in terms of Article 134, 138.4. And if there are disputes, they are resolved in terms of Article 140, and the president is sworn in terms of Article 141.
Mm.
When the president is sworn in, he's sworn in to serve a term of 5 years in terms of Article 141. And after those 5 years, elections will be held on the second Tuesday in the month of August. What I'm trying to do is this. I'm trying to lay bare, and of course, politicians know this. They know these timelines. These are things that are laid out clearly in the Constitution. They don't need a lawyer to read this or interpret them. So that is the predictable pathway. The reality is this.
Mm-hmm.
It was not a nice thing to have an election boycotted by NASA.
Mm.
It may turn out to be one of those a grave error in judgment,
right,
because then now it denied them an opportunity to participate in that election and also to contest its outcome.
Yeah.
But now the reality is that the Supreme Court helped to transition the country into the future. The future is now, we may discuss anything, but you'll not discuss how to go to an election within the next 5 years, except under the terms prescribed under Article 146, vacancy in the office of the presidency, the president, either if the president is dead, mm-hmm, in which case the deputy president takes over for the remainder of the term, or resignation, in which case both the president and the deputy must resign together, otherwise the deputy again takes over, or in terms of insanity, incapacity, lack of capacity to continue to govern, in which case again the deputy president. So the constitution has some constitutional controls, you know, for certainty, predictability, and continuity in the exercise of state power at the presidency level.
Right.
So within the constitution, talking as an advocate, I don't see opportunity. And I really pray now in 2018, we close that discussion of election within this year.
2018.
And then now so that we can open a discussion on electoral reform-related questions, and there are many.
Gentlemen,
that
despite
must
the
be
fact
discussed.
That despite the fact that Uhuru has said that dialogue will just have to wait come 2022.
No, dialogue cannot wait. Dialogue can't wait. What we need to do is proper framing.
That's
once you get the framing right. For instance, and I expect actually it's not the president's prerogative to initiate that dialogue. Even in terms of electoral reform, what is required to do, if you look at the role of a president under Article 131 of the Constitution, the symbol of national unity, as the head of state, he symbolizes national unity.
Right.
So he was supposed to say, well, if there are conflicts and controversy, dissensions and difficulties in the country, let me say openly to the people of Kenya that anybody who is aggrieved with anything, let us create a framework to communicate. That framework must be there. IBC must move quickly, and I hope they can give us a preliminary report, you get, of the election management, so that Kenyans can use that as the pathway to discussion, so that even as lawyers can go and tell IBC our views, the religious community can go and tell IBC their views, the political class, the peace experts can go and tell IBC lessons learned and how to improve election management, so that in 2022, we can see a significant shift. The tragedy will be if Kenya has no documented lessons and therefore nothing to learn from come 2022 elections.
Speaking of IEBC, Kenya's electoral body, come January 17th of 2017, we saw members of the National Assembly approving the new team. Daniel, how would you grade IEBC in terms of the last election that they conducted? And what more can we do, as Steve has said, to make sure that our independent electoral body, come the next election, is well catered for? They are not feeling threatened. I mean, we've seen what happened. Akombe resigned and the death of the former ICT manager, Chris Msando. What can they do better come 2022? But also first, how would you grade them with the last election?
Thank you very much. I think for the IBC, I've always been saying that our electoral infrastructure, you know, is structured in a way that it appears, it's perceived to be favoring any incumbent. You know, that perception is there. And IBC must make efforts to kick out that perception. You know, the perception that it is always favoring the incumbent.
Right.
Why am I saying this? And I've been saying that, you know, even if it was the opposition, if they were in power today, the same perception problem would be there. Because the way our politics is structured is that even if I'm the president, I may not want to be able to control, you know, the electoral body, the state machinery to favor me. But those people will naturally feel inclined, you know, to favor me. So this is the problem. So I think we need to work very, very hard. And I think our electoral experts, I was very disappointed because it is the lawyers, you know, the people who sat down earlier in this year and purported to restructure the IEBC. And I always said that we don't need to kick out individuals. Mm-hmm. We need to make sure that we have a system that is foolproof, a system that anybody can come and head it. But, you know, it's a system that will make sure that we deliver electoral justice,
right,
that we have universal suffrage, that the votes of the people count. So they sat down and came up with this system. Then we had the same problem. We're going back to the same problem. And again, we want to kick up the same IBC. So I'm thinking, I think once and for all, moving forward, right, I think we must have deliberate efforts to make sure that our electoral infrastructure allows a level playing field, so that you can come from the opposition and win an election, you know, like it has happened in a few countries. But as it is today, I can tell you, you know, in Kenya, it's a fact that no sitting president has ever been defeated in an election in Kenya.
Right. Yeah. Speaking of no sitting president has ever been defeated, it's Uhuru's last term. He has this next 5 years to make sure he secures a proper legacy. Steve, do you think that we'll see Uhuru be a bit more ruthless to anything or anybody who tries to come between him and that legacy he wants to leave behind?
If you allow, just before I comment on that, just something small on IBC.
Right.
I think although IBC came a bit late and lesson learned is that we should not replace IBC in the last 12 months to actually the last 2 years to an election. That we hope you can get to that level where let us reform IBC if at all when there's still time. But then for the time that they were in office, IBC had both problems that were both external to it and problems that were internal. Problems that were external is that there was a spirited attempt to manipulate IBC from outside. And that is an issue that was well admitted by the commission itself, including the chairman. Now, there are problems that are internal to IBC. IBC, as state of the constitution and the people of Kenya, have done everything to insulate IBC from external manipulation. You know, in our system, we have a system of insulation. You hire experts through a competitive process. Mm-hmm. You know, people who are thought to be non-partisan. in the West, in some countries in the West, they have a system of inoculation, meaning you hire people who are non-partisan so that they can perhaps fight each other or check each other. Maybe we might then debate that. Because if you have Kiraitu and Orengo sitting at the commission, Raila and Uhuru can be sure that nobody will shortchange each other. But when you have Dan and Gola, who are perceived to be independent, once we get there, we must maintain the perception that we are truly independent. Mm. IBC did not, to be honest, communicate with clarity every step of the way and openly what they were doing. You get? And that is what cost Uhuru Kenyatta the first election. Now, I think as we go forward, part of the question that must be interrogated is IBC's own management. Are they really competent, as their papers say? Because experience in terms of election management reveals obvious blunders. Mm. I think there will be a detailed forum in one of their forums for us to give our views. But I think they must learn from those mistakes and move from them, because managing an election is about perception. Other than showing that you care for the law, you must also not let the right-minded walk away thinking that you're either biased or incompetent. The perception, I think, I would tell you, Kenyans still felt that IBC was groping in the dark. It didn't really know what to do, and we're merely going through the legal process. That they must recapture and address with finality. But on this issue of, this issue of legacy, the reality is this. Uhuru is now serving his last term.
Right.
And if you read between the lines, and I want to already signal, there's what is called, there was the question about his legitimacy as a president, because a critical bloc did not vote. Mm. But if you look at the NASA fraternity, they're also changing tone. And they're saying, if Uhuru does not put us, Kalonzo said, if Uhuru cannot accept dialogue. Yeah. You know, there's a doctrine known as legitimacy through acquiesce. Yeah. If NASA is acquiescing that Uhuru is truly the president and all he needs to do is to open opportunity for dialogue, they're no longer saying that Uhuru must resign. Mm. That statement from Kalonzo signifies in a dramatic shift of understanding. And that's something that Uhuru, if I were Uhuru, I would capitalize on that.
Yes, yeah. That you'll now, accept that invitation.
Yeah, that people are beginning to accept, you know, the reality that I'm the president. Mm. And people means the NASA leadership. Because they're saying, I should create room for conversation. When I'm creating room for conversation, I'm creating room as the head of state and head of government, and that have my legal obligation to make sure that all voices are included.
Yes.
That's a good signal. Mm. So he must, if he cares for his legacy, he must leave this country more united than it was, because he's the first president to serve full term under the new constitution.
Right.
He was elected in 2013, now elected in 2017. He must leave this country truly united. Mm-hmm. And then he also has his own four key pillars. I think he talks about food security.
Education.
He talks about education. He talks about healthcare. And he talks about housing. Mm-hmm. I think on those critical pillars, the four pillars that he rests his legacy on, I would urge him to include some low-hanging fruits, like promote inclusiveness, mm-hmm. create room for that dialogue, mm-hmm. show that the government is determined to comply with the law. In the last 5 years, we have seen a government that is outrightly unrepentant. The court says do this, they don't do it. You know?
And we'll come to talk about the issue of courts.
I think minimum compliance with the law, respect for human rights, entrenching a culture of a rule of law,
right.
Public participation, inclusiveness, those are low-hanging fruits that are easy to achieve. As long as there's a change of attitude in your technique of governance.
Daniel, do you agree with Steve when it comes to Uhuru, and do you think that he will be a bit more ruthless now that he's serving his last term, and what sort of legacy he wants to leave? How history will remember him?
I think ruthless is not the right word. You know, as a president, he is basically serving the people. When you are serving the people, there's no space for ruthlessness. You know, we just need the president to abide by the constitution, by the rule of law, to bring the nation together. Mm-hmm. Our elections, you know, basically, you know, does not provide, our political system doesn't provide for opposition and government zones. Mm-hmm. You know, even if you look at our parliament today, you know, there is no opposition and we only have minority and majority. Mm-hmm. And as you can see in parliament, everyone is a state officer, even the members of opposition. Mm-hmm. Are now, you know, seated in those parliamentary seats, and just like I said that, like you said, you know, the president needs to grasp, you know, the chance. Just like he has said that the kind of legitimacy by acquiescence. You can see the members of the opposition are already seated. The Public Investment Committee, the Public Accounts Committee. Initially, they said they are boycotting those seats. Mm. But now they have accepted and they have sat on those seats. So that should send a message to the president and to the nation that actually, you know, these people are actually accepting, albeit, you know, grudgingly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm.
So it is he needs to seize the moment and make deliberate efforts to bring the nation together. And I think right now, if I were the president, I would focus especially on the areas that did not vote for me. Mm. You know, the Nyanza, Western, Mombasa, and just tell them, look, I am your president. You know, you may not agree with me, but that is the law. I mean, the constitution which you voted for
stipulates that.
Stipulates that I am your president at this moment.
Yeah.
And I want to serve everyone. So I need to hear from you how I can be able to serve you better. And I think in terms of moving forward, I'm looking at devolution. You know, I think the president should make efforts to make sure that more resources go to the counties. He should also improve relationship with the governors, mm-hmm. especially opposition governors,
right.
So that he can be able to rely on those governors. Right now, as you know, the president relies mostly on the county commissioners, the commissioners. But I'm thinking if he can forge friendly relationship with the governors, I think he is in a good position today to bring the nation together. Mm. And he needs to seize this opportunity. But of course, you know, they are hardliners. Hardliners both in Jubilee and in NASA,
right.
Who would not allow any kind of sober discussion to go on.
Because they know what that will mean.
Yes.
Steve, you touched on the issue of courts. We've seen President Uhuru come out and warn the courts saying, do not put any roadblocks on major projects. How do you think that relationship between President Uhuru Kenyatta and the judiciary will play out?
I think he must work to rehabilitate that relationship because it's fractured in a way because he attempted to delegitimize the courts when courts annulled his win. Although later on when he was meeting judges, he explained that that is just part of the usual criticism,
mm-hmm.
but it was the kind of criticism that then crossed the line.
Right.
I think the president must preserve the independence of the judiciary, the judiciary must preserve their own independence, because you see, the pillars of the Constitution, other than the robust framework of the Constitution,
mm-hmm.
and a strengthened Bill of Rights, the other critical pillar is a robust, independent, and functional judiciary. Mm. Judiciary and the executive are not necessarily mutually exclusive. Mm. So he's not out of tune when he's saying, at least make decisions that also take into consideration public policy issues. That's okay. But trying to twist the judiciary or trying to change the judiciary or co-opt them as into the executive's vision, you know, or making them a mere extension of the executive, I think that would be to reverse the gains that Kenya has realized, and Kenyans will resist that. You know, what we need is compliance with the law. In 2017, there were many laws against the government and government agencies that have not been complied with. A case in point is Parliament. I'm talking about government in terms of the political wing of government, both mm-hmm. the presidency and both the executive and the National Assembly. The president was told last year by the High Court that when you are establishing the cabinet, ensure that the cabinet respects the two-thirds gender principle.
Mm-hmm.
So we hope that Uhuru Kenyatta, as he's reorganizing his cabinet, that he will capture that. The government was also told to commence the Public Benefits Organizations Act, the law that regulates civil society. Instead, the government has heightened the attack on civil society. We want that law passed. Because it's just, you are in contempt of court. Why? It's just a question of complying with court orders. Now, there are other several instances where the government has shown reluctance in terms of complying with court orders.
Mm-hmm.
I think court orders, and I like how the Chief Justice statements, what he made, what he told the president when they met recently, when the president was meeting the judges,
mm-hmm.
he said they will support the government in terms of interpreting the law in a manner that does not disrupt the policy shifts that the government, the executive, is trying to implement. But where the government is clearly out of step with the law, they will also say so. The problem comes when the executive chooses what to comply with and what not to comply with. There's an opportunity to disinherit bad manners and entrench a culture of decency. I think we are dealing with what we need is soft issues. You know, if we can create a culture of decency, a culture of compliance, everything will fall into place. I understand the president, he cares for his legacy and he wants to rein in into errant politicians, but he will not succeed. Because Kenya is a democratic state, it is not possible to compare it with Uganda. It is not possible to compare it with the pre-2010 country or experience. The reality is that now, bickering can go on forever. So you need some level of cleverness, some insight, how to manage the country to allow you to govern effectively while capturing the views of the people. But a more collaborative, consultative approach would be beneficial to the country.
All right, gentlemen, let's shift gears a little bit and move from Jubilee and Uhuru camp to now NASA. Mr. Raila Odinga has lost 3 elections in a row. Age is catching up. Do you think he will still remain, he needs to remain relevant, or his supporters will feel jinxed? Daniel, your thoughts?
Of course, he needs to remain relevant. I think in terms of Raila Odinga, you know, whether he becomes president or not, he already has a legacy.
Right.
You know, he will always be remembered as someone who actually put the government on toes. You know, he fought for the democratic space that we enjoy. Today, I can sit here and criticize the president without fear that some policeman will be waiting for me at home.
Right.
You know, these are the kind of democratic benefits that we have gained, and we must give it to Raila Odinga. I think in terms of his legacy, I think moving forward, I think he needs to really sit down and decide, you know, how he wants to basically bring his legacy, you know, moving forward. And I would really look at the people around him today, just like the people around the president. The people around Raila Odinga, you know, will be responsible, were responsible, even if you look at the manner in which he withdrew from the elections. I am one of the person who believes that Raila Odinga should never have boycotted those elections. But of course, his advisors, you know, the close advisors, I think they had their reasons, and they thought that if he withdraws in the manner which he withdrew, then the elections would move forward. And as you can see, that backfired seriously.
Yes.
And I mean, some of those advisors who actually made that legal mistake, by now, I think they should have stepped aside. You know, you shouldn't have replaced them,
and,
you know?
Right, and speaking of stepping aside, Steve, do you think that it's time for Raila Odinga to step aside and let another co-principal take the lead when it comes to presidency?
I think the argument for stepping aside is not founded in law. then because, unlike Uganda, Kenya does not have age limit on, and it's not necessary
right.
in a democratic state to set age limits of people who can vie. Age limit is for the exercise of public, term limit is for the exercise of public authority. You must be exercised for a limited period of time. Maybe once you're elected, you have an opportunity to renew yourself or maybe succeed yourself only once. But they say that no one knows the mind of man except the Lord himself. So, whether Raila should continue to be in politics or maybe retire, that's a decision only Raila can make. What we know is this, the incontestable fact. If Raila chooses to remain in politics, he will maintain his relevance. So I don't think it's true to say that Raila is done and dusted and he's become irrelevant in this post-2017 election. Other than the politics of elective offices, Raila's legacy is well documented and perhaps may only be comparable to sitting presidents or maybe those who have served. If you are writing Kenya's history, a whole chapter will be dedicated to Raila Odinga.
Oh, yeah.
Where we have reached so far, much of it can be attributed to his indefatigable attitude. I like the fact that part of the benefits of a democratic state is that the government is porous in nature. And Raila has a very, you know, he has this way of getting government figures and information through his own networks. And I think that has really made him put the government to task. If Raila were to miss, if Raila were to retire from politics voluntarily, we would really miss him. because he was the person, he was the person who was always setting the agenda. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Remember the NOS scandal? Nobody thought it was a scandal that was. It came out to be a real issue. Remember the May scandal? Everything that has happened in this country that shapes the destiny of this Kenya, of this country, Raila has had a significant input in it.
Right.
Even the ongoing reforms, he will still have a significant input. We must acknowledge, however, that at the ballot, the greatest weakness of an emerging democracy is that our politics is largely ethnic-based. Mm-hmm. And if you're able to put together communities that support each other, you know, it's not necessarily unconstitutional to vote in an ethnic way. Because if Kenyans choose to organize their ideas around one their person, that is not any different from stable democracies where people organize their ideas, their choices around ideas and ideologies. What is discouraging, perhaps, in Kenyan politics because of the ethnic nature, is that you may have someone who perhaps means well, like Raila Odinga, but will never get a real chance to serve as long as he doesn't cobble a winning coalition. The tyranny of numbers is still a reality, but Raila himself also recognizes and he acknowledges. Remember when he was in Siaya, there was a lady who gave him the Bible and told him, swear. He did not. When he was in Mombasa, he managed to starve off the pressure from Coast MPs to swear himself. I think he also understands that in all this, the politics of the country, he must preserve his reputation as the father of democracy. Mm. He will not allow that reputation to be, let's say, to be discredited, you know, or to will not disinherit himself of that reputation because of political moves in this short term. If he wants to be relevant, if he wants to be succeeded by Kalonzo or Mudavadi, that only him and the coalition partners will decide. But I think what also the other NASA core principles must work hard to ensure, I don't think it would be a wise idea for Kalonzo or maybe Mudavadi to expect a direct endorsement.
Right.
That would be naivety of the highest order. They must work to win their support, the support base. First of all, the confidence of Raila and his supporters, mm-hmm. the Luo Nyanza bloc, for instance, because mm-hmm. they have a near fanatical following, not even a near, a fanatical following of Raila Odinga.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they must consolidate their bases if they want to stand a chance. But this, what I've heard now, some NASA, section of NASA coalition members, their money ANC wing saying it's now Mudavadi's turn and Raila must endorse.
And
that argument may disappoint them big time, because Raila might decide to stay the course.
Right.
And his ability to craft another coalition
right.
cannot be underrated or downplayed. Mm. He may even work with Ruto.
And that's the thing. Do you think that even his very own running mate, Mr. Kalonzo, has that Odinga magic that will help him see him convince Wetangula and Mudavadi to continue backing him up?
Mm. They don't have that magic.
Daniel
honest.
And you.
I think, yeah, but give it to me, Mr. Kalonzo. Kalonzo Musyoka has been, a diplomat for quite a long year, mm-hmm. a long time. He served as a foreign affairs minister for a very long time. And I think he would have the ability,
mm-hmm.
But not compare, we can't compare that to Mr. Raila Odinga. Mr. Odinga's ability to cobble down coalitions is out of this world, mm-hmm. so you must give it to him, you know. Nobody thought that, for example, he would bring Kalonzo and even Mudavadi and for them to say they're supporting him. So I think that ability is something that only Raila Odinga has. But moving forward, I think, just like he said, I think Kalonzo and Mudavadi and all the other people who want to inherit Raila's political constituency must work hard to be able to inherit that.
Mm.
You know, the kind of working hard, you could see, like, for example, what Joho does.
Mm-hmm.
Joho is very, very pragmatic. He has the ability to actually... Sometimes you inherit by serving, by appearing to be serving. Like what Joho used to do is he appeared to be serving him and endorsing him.
That's how he won his heart.
That's what the supporters, his followers, are seeing.
Mm-hmm.
The same thing is what perhaps... Kalonzo and Mudavadi needs to do. But if you look at Mudavadi, he changed over the last few months, the way he has been, you know, even at the rallies, you know, the way you could see NASA, the stuff like that. So I think he managed to change. And sometimes you inherit by serving and by not appearing to be wanting to inherit. Mm. Even for deputy presidents, you can see if for the most successful vice presidents are the ones that sat quietly and were never seen to be ambitious, overly ambitious. Mm. Those ones were successful. You could see Daniel Arap Moi during Kenyatta time. He was very quiet. Nobody thought he would make it, but he made it. So it's the same kind of thing.
And gentlemen, speaking of Mudavadi, those who are both inside and outside of the NASA coalition see leadership in him. Mm. And the thing is, even before Uhuru Ruto, Mount Kenya had quite a soft spot for Mudavadi. He comes also with quite a big connection with Rift Valley. Mudavadi plays quite a stronghold and a threat to the Jubilee government, especially if you put both Mudavadi and Mr. Kalonzo. That is going to be quite a team to wrestle with for Jubilee. Right, Steve?
Yeah. I think all leaders, all NASA leaders and Jubilee leaders are capable of giving us a president. Political formations usually change based on emerging interests. Mm-hmm. And it's not beyond our political elite to create new formations that may even include Raila and Ruto working together, because they have worked together before. Kalonzo was part of the G7. In fact, it was his understanding that he was the preferred candidate. You know, then he bolted out. Mudavadi, in 2013, ran alone. Part of the reason why he came back, he joined CORD and then formed NASA, is because in between he felt shortchanged by Uhuru mm-hmm. and Ruto. Mm-hmm. Because there was a discussion that they would support him. Mm. You know, that shows you that what politicians care for is a winning formula.
Yeah.
These formations, NASA and Jubilee formations, these are just vehicles to pursue certain interests. For me, as a Kenyan and as an election observer and someone who's keen on governance, what I would really want to understand from this political elite, is this competition for elective office also competition for service?
Right.
Because it could as well be that competition for elective office is as well a hidden agenda for competition for personal aggrandizement.
Yeah.
You know, you want to be co-opted into the class of the privileged, because Kenya is still struggling with tackling corruption. And what corruption means is that if you're in government, there can't be, you can't say that Kenya is deeply corrupt or corruption is deeply entrenched, and then you excuse those in government. If Kenya's corruption perception index is still at 145 out of 183 countries, what that means is that, honestly, we can reasonably, or we can make the charitable assumption that people in government use those opportunities in government to benefit themselves.
Right.
Now, the political elite know this. So then they are saying, How about we change this set from that other this one set of thieves with another set of thieves? Can we really say with certainty that the NASA coalition represents the alternative leadership
that
this country needs? I think for me that is the more concerning issue. Or can we say that Ruto and Uhuru Kenyatta in this second term, that they now reflect the desperation of ordinary Kenyans? The desperation of ordinary Kenyan is that we have some culture of decency in our politics, that we earn honestly, you know, that we also have, that you lower the cost of living and you make government as open as it can get, and people who are serving in government do not necessarily use those opportunities to benefit. That is the desperation of Kenyans. Can Uhuru and Ruto say that they can capture that?
Right.
And when they leave office, can Raila and NASA team say that they can continue with that vision?
Mm.
Or is this just a struggle for co-option into the club of resource managers? For me, which is what it seems to me.
Steve, allow me to shift gears, gentlemen, and that's the issue of desperation. Let's touch a little bit on road carnage. It's something that has really, really touched the country over this month alone. We've seen 330 people die just on road accidents in the month of December. Mm. Let's have a listen into this clip, then we'll come and close off this discussion with the issue of road carnage. Have a look.
This stretch is a Changwani to Salga. We have lost many people in this month of December alone. So it is a question of our personal responsibility as road users, either as a driver, either as a passenger. And it is not only restricted to public service vehicles, it's also even private personal vehicles. We need to exercise a lot of restraint by avoiding overtaking in dangerous places, corners, and along the yellow line. We need to carry enough passengers. The drivers need to be in a good frame of mind so that we avoid all these things. And we have lost quite a number of people here. This particular one is horrific. It is sad, it is unfortunate. But as government, we'll continue, because we have already put the pumps and we are continuing to do. Even if there is a program to open up another road, the other side, from the other side of Kibunja, to come and link up the other side, that is ongoing. It's an ongoing thinking that is in the works. So government is committed and is doing all these things. But we are also asking ourselves as Kenyans, me and you included, how are we behaving when we are on the public road? Is our behavior? Let us be responsible.
From yesterday's accident, about 36 people perished, 26 were adults and about 3 others were kids. Total number for the lives lost in December stands at around 330. December alone, the year, that number was put at around 2,800. Steve, I really want to hear your thoughts on this, given the fact that now NTSA has put a ban on traveling, and whether that really limits the freedom of Kenyans, how that even affects Kenyans in terms of the economy. And that means we're just saying that we're accepting the fact that night accidents just happen at night. The accidents that happen during the day.
Yeah. I think NTSA's spectacular fail is well documented, and so is the CS for transport, James Masharia. Major and Masharia should resign. I mean, they should just spare us this high talk and resign because of these 3 reasons. The major causes for accident, number one, is fatigue. Mm-hmm. Public service drivers, they drive in the day, they drive in the night. Why is the government unable to ensure that all licensed PSV vehicles have an alternate driver in that bus? Why? That doesn't require innovation. That just requires enforcement. Now, the other one is indiscipline. Our road drivers, road users, both private motorists and public service vehicles, are just indisciplined. We don't observe lane discipline. We overtake. Why do we have CCTVs and patrol cars, NTC patrol cars, to arrest that? If people know that the cost of indiscipline on the road will be a significant inconvenience, then people will begin to behave. But there's a culture of complacency. There's a culture of corruption. So you know you can change lanes and get away with it. Mm-hmm. The third one, which I think is now biting NTSA over speeding. NTSA, these speed guns have become, these are just toll stations. They hide somewhere in a particular corner. We don't even know whether those cameras are functional, but they tell you you are over speeding. You do know, people who drive in this country know that you can negotiate with NTSA or those plus the police officers who are there, give them money and you're let go. Mm. Yeah. So really, overspeeding has no real consequence. So who is in charge? Who is in charge, or who is responsible for enforcing the law? The CS Transport, in terms of providing that leadership, has failed. NTSA, instead of enforcing the law, theirs is just to showcase a presence on the roads. Mm-hmm. You know, I think if that is the approach to work, then they have failed. So all this, if you look at what is causing road carnage? The indiscipline, the recklessness, the fatigue, and the overspeeding. All these are issues that the government can address, which they have failed to address, and innocent Kenyans are dying every day, and we are changing statistics. Telling Kenyans that now we have banned night travel is more reactionary that is intended to inspire confidence.
All right,
because in solutions being done. Because in any case, travel at night is even more safer because there are lesser cars on the road. Mm-hmm. What is causing lack of concentration on the road and accidents, mm-hmm, is that these drivers are fatigued.
Daniel, your 2 cents on this, mm-hmm, especially now that we need to wind up.
Yeah, I think it is very sad that we lost 36 people yesterday, just one day before they saw the new year.
Right.
It's very sad. And the 330, that's quite a long, mm-hmm, that's a big number. I can only say we miss former Minister Michuki. He had the ability to bring discipline in our roads. You know, at a time when we were not, people were standing in matatus, he put that to a stop. He managed to enforce safety belts. Just like you said, you know, and I've happened to drive, you know, along that road, you know, especially Kisumu Nakuru Road. You know, the lane indiscipline is just too much. But the biggest problem, you know, on the road is perhaps, you know, law enforcement. This country needs 2 things, especially 2018. If we are to move forward as a country, we need to reform our education system and also our security system, so that our children, we start learning, you know, from the young age that we need to observe the law. My children, when I'm driving, they always make sure that I'm having my seatbelt. If I forget, they say, "Daddy, you have forgotten to put on your seatbelt." Mm-hmm. So people don't need to be told, you know, that you don't need the policeman to tell you to put on the seatbelt.
It's common sense.
It should be common sense. But the problem is we just overspeed when we send. We know that there's no policeman here, so we overspeed. So I think it's a bad culture that we need to reform. And I think moving forward, NTSA should invest more in educating the people, not in hiding and arresting and taking bribes from people. Right. This is a big problem.
Gentlemen, thank you so much for your thoughts this morning. That was Daniel Juma Omondi, the Executive Director at Global Peace Foundation, as well as Steve Okolo, a High Court advocate, just sharing their thoughts with us on the events that shaped 2017 and even truly moving forward 2018. What were some of those events that stood up for you? Make sure you tweet us at KTN News, at Zinzi_K. We want to take a